Please join me in welcoming Erica and Kelly.
Thank you very much, and thanks for coming. I'm going to remind everybody to turn their cell phones off. So whenever they ring, I think it's for me. Well, the operative word this morning is new. New spaces, new ideas about display, and new innovations during the 19th century. I'm going to cough, and then I'm going to be fine. All right. When we opened this new building, a lot of people assumed that they were going to just see their old favorites, and I show you some of them here, including some of my particular favorites. I think you'll understand why. And we wanted, as you can see in the galleries, to feature those works, but also to do something new with them. We didn't want people to come to the museum and just think that they were going to see exactly what they saw in the old galleries and exactly the pictures used in the same way that they had become familiar with. And so we tried to change things up, think about new themes that these works could illustrate, and also bring into the picture a lot of new acquisitions. From Lois's introduction, you know that we spent a long time working on the wing of Art of the Americas, really from 2001 until it opened in 2010. And over that time, we did acquire a lot of new objects, including all the pictures that you see on the screen right now, which we're going to be looking at together. I hope a lot of these pictures will become new favorites at the MFA, new go-to paintings that everybody wants to see. And I want to show you how they both fit into our collection and also how they change what we can do, how they shift what stories we can tell about the collection. All of these pictures, and the theme I've chosen for today, is about connections between American art and other parts of the world, specifically Europe and Asia. And all of the paintings that you see here allow us to tell a very different, very cosmopolitan kind of story that we've never emphasized in quite the same way before. I'm going to start with this one, which has become one of my favorites. I absolutely love it. It's by an artist named John Humphreys Johnston, and it's called Le Domino Rose. A domino is simply a big voluminous cape, which is what she's wearing. You might have heard of that term if you've ever looked at 18th century views of Venice, because all of those people wearing capes and masks, that cape was called a domino. And Le Domino Rose just means the pink robe. It was made in about 1895, and I hope you're not worried if you've never heard of John Humphreys Johnston, because when this painting came on the market, I'd never heard of John Humphreys Johnston either, and I haven't heard about him very much since then either, except through the efforts we've made here to learn more about him. It turns out that Johnston, who I've seen no photograph of ever, was a wealthy New Yorker. He came from a family that was very involved with the Metropolitan Museum of Art. Some of you might have heard of their great patron, John Taylor Johnston, who was, in fact, the same family. And Johnston, the painter, began his career in New York as an apprentice to this man, John Lafarge, who you see here in a portrait from our own collection by an artist named Wilton Lockwood. Lafarge, as you know, was a great public artist, working on enormous campaigns, especially for church spaces like Trinity Church that you see on the lower left, or the Church of the Ascension in New York on the right. The Church of the Ascension is an older Gothic style church. It was built, the architect was Richard Upjohn. It was built in 1841. But in 1889, the entire interior was renovated by an architectural firm you may have heard of, McKim, Mead & White. the great New York architects who really did work across the entire Eastern Seaboard and much of the United States. Their most famous building in Boston is the Boston Public Library. So Lafarge was tasked with being one of the chief decorators of these two spaces, and Johnson began his career as an apprentice to Lafarge. At Trinity, we know a lot about Lafarge designs for the interior, and the idea of having art in these sacred spaces is very much part of late 19th century ideas about how art can lift your soul out of the ordinary, that it can lift you, uplift you, inspire you, and that art has a power that's very much in sync with the spiritual goals of these sacred spaces. In Trinity, Lafarge did windows that we've all seen. He also did the mural paintings in the tower. And his campaign there was similar to what he did at the Church of the Ascension in New York. You see glass of the type that Lafarge did for the Church of the Ascension. This particular window is actually out of a different church, a church in Detroit. The window is now in the Detroit Art Institute, which means we have photographs of it. Let me tell you, it's not so easy sometimes to get a good shot of a stained glass window that's still in situ in a church. And at the lower left, I'm showing you Lafarge's mural from the Church of the Ascension that shows the Ascension of Christ. You can just see that happening here. Kelly's going to talk a little bit about Lafarge's stained glass, and I'm showing you just an example from our own collection at the lower right, our peony window, which I know Kelly will discuss with you further, but I want to remind you that Lafarge is well represented in our own galleries as well. Johnston worked with Lafarge on a window in the Church of the Ascension, the Lathrop Memorial window that was devoted to the vision of St. John. Just by the fact that he was interested in stained glass, we know that Johnston was interested in color, and that's something that I think comes out pretty clearly in his wonderful Domino Rose. As I said, we know very, very little about him other than that. We know that he studied in Paris. We know that he was interested in both figurative and landscape painting, and I'm showing you one of the few other works by Johnston I've seen on the right of a bridge at Toledo in Spain. And we know that he studied further in Paris, traveled to Spain, as so many artists did in the late 19th century, and that he really established his career in the 1890s in Paris. Domino Rose was shown at the great Salon exhibition in 1895, and then it was shipped to the United States, where it was shown at the Pennsylvania Academy in 1896. There are two works by Johnston in the French National Collections, and that's it. That's all I know. If you know more or have one in your attic, I hope you'll come talk to me. But I think even from these two pictures, you can see that he was a painter of great skill. We can tell a lot about La Domino Rose just by looking at it. It fits in completely with other decorative images of women that were painted in the 1890s. And I'm showing you one at the upper left by John White Alexander, one at the lower left by Thomas Anschutz, one at the upper right by William Merritt Chase, and one at the bottom right by Julius Stewart. And you can see there's a whole vocabulary of these, what I call decorative images of women. They're about beauty, they're about line, they're about form and color, and the Johnston piece fits very nicely into that. It's possible that it might have had something to do with a popular piano piece of the 1890s, a French piece called La Domino Rose. Whether there's a musical connection to this painting, we aren't quite sure. It was a piece by the French composer Berdal. And it's not unusual for pictures at this period to have musical connections and musical resonance. The decorative aspects of this picture are its color harmonies, and take a look at the wonderful range of tones in that red robe that contrast with the slightly different red of the woman's hair and the scarlet of the flower that she's got stuck in her hair. This is a picture of great sophisticated color harmonies that also link it to works in our collection by artists like John White Alexander, whose Isabella and the Pot of Basil you see on the left, and James McNeil Whistler, whose Little Rose of Lyme Regis you see at the upper right. And I'm showing you at lower right an etching by Whistler, very much in this vocabulary of decorative works, decorative images of women. Well, it might not come as a surprise to you to find out that Johnston knew both John White Alexander and Whistler in Paris. Both of them had studios there in the 1890s, and we know from surviving correspondence that they were in touch with one another. Well, we all thought this painting was beautiful. We could see the links between it and other works in our collection. The question is, what were we going to do with it? And when our colleague Elliot Davis realized that it fit in this empty hole we had, it was a given that we were going to go ahead and buy it. We were being given this fireplace surround by a collector of aesthetic movement material. The fireplace came from a house on Commonwealth Avenue. It's sort of half Chinese and half Bostonian, in deference to the woman who used to live in that house, Elizabeth Spooner, who had spent quite a long time as a in Asia herself. And this fireplace, we thought, might be an appropriate centerpiece for the aesthetic movement gallery we were creating. Well, the painting that used to be in the middle of it was long gone, and we didn't know what to do. The former owner had a mirror in it, which didn't seem like anything that we would want to do in our galleries. So we had a number of different ideas, but when this painting fit exactly into the space that we had available, we thought this was a sign and we really should go ahead and write a check. And I think you can see that the entire vignette in the aesthetic movement gallery is really brought together by not just the individual objects that are in it, but also by the way they all look together. And here in the galleries, we see Johnston reunited with Lafarge, whose still life you see here, with another Lafarge still life, and with Whistler, all now combined together in a way that tells you a whole lot about the 1890s just by putting things together and not only by studying individual works. The second painting that I want to talk to you about is also a French one. It's this one by John Leslie Breck. It's called In the Valley of the Seine, and it dates from 1889. Now, Breck isn't that well known, but you might know who this guy is. This is Claude Monet on the right, with one of Boston's Monets on the left, Meadow at Giverny from 1885. You might know that Monet became incredibly popular in Boston throughout the United States, but especially in Boston at quite an early time. And partly because so many collectors were interested in Monet's work, American artists began to adopt his painting style and also some of his subject matters. The practice of painting outdoors was something that had been going on for a long time, and I'm just showing you here two works by John Singer Sargent on the upper level, Sargent's view of Dennis Miller Bunker painting out of doors on the upper left, and Sargent's view of Monet painting out of doors at the upper right. And if you look carefully at this picture, it's that. So we have Sargent documenting the creation of one of the paintings in our collection. The Sargent, unfortunately, doesn't belong to us. It belongs to the Tate, but we try to borrow it at every opportunity. I'm showing you at the bottom a sort of joke, a cartoon by the French artist Honoré Daumier showing the hard work that it was to paint out of doors. Well, we were interested in these American followers of Monet and wanted to create for our audience some impression of that connection between American and French art at the end of the 19th century. And we had an unmatched collection of Monet's work and a lot of early examples of works by American followers of Monet. I'm showing you two of our other Monets here at the left, and our great Tarbell, Mother and Child in the Boat from 1892, one of the early American examples of an artist who wholesaledly threw himself into Impressionism. But interestingly enough, what we didn't own were any paintings of Giverny by the many artists, American artists, who were the first people to travel there. On the upper left, Breck. We didn't own a Breck at that point. At the upper right, Metcalf. We had later works by Metcalf, but none of his Giverny pictures. Or at the bottom, Wendell, Theodore Wendell, another artist from the Boston area. So many of these early travelers to Giverny were from Boston, and yet their work was entirely unrepresented in the collection. So when we had a chance to buy this important Breck that had descended entirely within the family of the artist, we really jumped to it because it provided a missing link between our French Impressionist holdings and American art. Breck, who you see here at the upper right in a photograph, has an interesting sort of family background. He was born at sea near Guam, but raised in Newton. His father was a ship captain, if you hadn't figured that out, and yes, his mother was on the boat. He studied in Boston first, then went to Germany. He studied in Paris. And he, like Wendell, Philip Hale, Metcalf, and others, was among this first group of American artists to travel to Giverny. I'm showing you three other examples of Breck's work here. French meadow with those distinctive pollarded willows at the upper left. And at the bottom, two American scenes, one of wild asters at the lower left, and on the right, a view of Ipswich. Unlike a lot of the American artists who traveled to France, Breck really became one of the few to enter Monet's inner circle, and in fact carried on sort of a love affair with one of Monet's stepdaughters. He moved back to the United States in 1890, and he was described as one of the very progressive artists who, and I quote from the Art Amateur magazine, one of the artists who has gotten the blue-green color of Monet's Impressionism and got it bad. While Breck started painting French scenes, he then transferred his skills to New England landscapes like the two you see at the bottom here. He died in 1899 at the young age of 39 at the St. Botolph Club of gas poisoning, and the jury is out on whether that was self-inflicted or not. I keep thinking I'm going to write the novel. Forget art history, I'll just write the novel. Now, our new painting, which you see at upper left, again, is one of Breck's most ambitious scenes, showing the entire river valley from the heights above Giverny. And this is a photograph of the same scene taken from the heights at Giverny. What you see in the distance are poplar trees, something that we know Monet explored in great pictures like the one at the upper right. And I'm also showing you a work by another American artist, Theodore Robinson, of the Valley at the Seine at lower right, a painting in the Corcoran's collection, so that you can see there really was this whole community of American artists painting in Giverny, really in Monet's circle, and that this Breck now links together the European collection and the American collections in a new, exciting way. Well, another French artist, another American artist who worked in France, who I want to introduce you to, is a man named Robert Vana. And this is his Springtime in France from 1890. Vana, too, was a Bostonian. He first studied at the Massachusetts Normal Art School, now known as the Mass College of Art and Design. You see his self-portrait here at the left. And he became really best known as a portraitist, particularly for dark, dignified, sort of boardroom portraits of men. Vana began to teach at the School of the Museum of Fine Arts, and then he went back to France for a few years, where he started to paint in this outdoor, sun-filled, impressionist style that we've already seen in Brecht's work. I'm showing you two of Vana's pictures at the right, his big salon piece, which shows a woman and children in a poppy field in France. Those of you who have had the good fortune to travel there will have seen these big fields of red poppies. Something happens when art lasts through time. The painting at the bottom right is now called In Flanders Field, which of course has all to do with the First World War and the symbolism of the red poppy, although at the time it was painted, World War I, of course, hadn't happened yet. I'm showing you at the upper right a painting some of you might have seen. We included it in our Americans in Paris show a couple of years ago, and I want to point out to you that even in these very bright, sunlit, impressionist scenes, Vana was working in a more academic, studio-based technique. The painting at the upper right could be a sketch, in fact, for the painting at the lower right. He was making sketches outdoors, bringing them back into his studio, and then making bigger figurative compositions like the one you see at the right. We're not sure whether our painting, Springtime in France, is also a sketch for a larger piece. For example, the Vana painting that you see on the right, also called Springtime in France, also dating from 1890, and which shares a lot of compositional similarities to ours. The painting on your right is now at the Art Institute of Chicago. But why would we be interested in going for something that is just a sketch for another museum's painting? Well, the Vana does a lot of things for us, again, opening doors between the American collections and other parts of the MFA. What it reminds us of is the intense connection between the Impressionist style and Japanese art. I'm showing you here a Monet with a Japanese print on the right, but look at our Vana with a Japanese print. This is Hiroshige's Forest of the Sujin Shrine from 1856. And I think you can see that compositionally, Vana is very much beholden to his study of Japanese prints. With the bands of the composition, here, 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 very much in the same technique as the Japanese print you see on the right. The way those bands tend to flatten the compositional space so that the surface design becomes very important, and also, of course, that overhanging branch with its bunches of flowers. Vana's work is now hanging in a gallery devoted to Boston and the Impressionist movement, but he could equally well be used in a totally different way on another occasion to talk about the relationship between Japan and the West. And it's those kinds of doors opening that we wanted to allow ourselves in this new wing, which I think you'll all agree is quite different in the messages that it sends from our old spaces. I want to switch now from France to England and take a look at this wonderful painting by Edwin Austin Abbey called A Pavane and dating from 1897. We're sticking firmly in the 1890s here. Abbey, who you see here at upper left in a pencil charcoal sketch by his good friend John Singer Sargent, Abby was from Philadelphia. He began his career as an illustrator, working for Harper's Magazine. And in 1878, he moved pretty much permanently to England, where he worked both in London and in a studio in the countryside in a small town called Broadway that you might have heard about because it's where John Singer Sargent also spent a lot of time. You might be familiar with Abby's work if you've gone to the Boston Public Library, and I'm showing you here two images of the great Abby mural cycle from the BPL. In the upper right is the book delivery room, or at least it used to be the book delivery room, on the second floor of the library. These wonderful murals have recently been restored, and if you're in the library, you shouldn't miss a chance to see them. I'm showing you at the bottom one of the panels. It's this panel. There are 15 of them all together, and they all illustrate the great quest for the Holy Grail, that medieval saga that is common to the literature of lots of different places. And so Abby thought it would be a good subject for the Boston Public Library, which too brought together the literature of a lot of different places. You can see by the fact that he did this mural commission that Abby was interested in art as part of a greater decorative scheme, this time domestic and secular, rather than the sacred spaces we were looking at before. Well, our painting was also part of a decorative scheme. It was painted for an interior in this building, the Villard Houses in New York on the corner of Madison Avenue and 50th Street. It was at the time the home of Whitelaw Reed, who was the publisher of the New York Tribune. I'm showing you at the upper left the exterior of the houses. They were designed by McKim, Mead, and White in 1884. It's a 6-apartment complex in these two buildings that draw very much on Italian Renaissance palazzi as a precedent. And I'll let you do the sort of putting together of an American millionaire taking on the persona of an Italian patron of the arts. But that's exactly what's going on here. Well, in the 1890s, Whitelaw Reed took over one of these apartments and asked his friend Stanford White to redecorate it for him. And Abby was asked to do the overmantel for the dining room. You see it here on the right in its original setting. The room survives. This complex is now the New York Palace Hotel. This is their dining room, one of the restaurants in the New York Palace Hotel, now called Gilt. That's G-I-L-T, not G-U-I-L-T, although you may feel guilty after you eat there. And I think you can see that they've since decorated it with a photo blow-up, unfortunately, of the wrong painting by Abby. Well, Abby did this painting in England and sent it to the United States, and where it was installed in the dining room of Whitelaw Reed's house until about the 1950s, when descendants of Whitelaw Reed finally dismantled the fittings and the personal possessions and sold that house. The painting went into a private collection. It appeared on the market in a auction that was devoted to old cars. So whatever your interests are, you never know what you're going to find. And when we bought it, it was simply in a gold strip frame, which was fine in the old galleries, but it really wasn't going to do in the new ones. So for the wing, we very much wanted to recreate a sense of that original glamour of the dining room, give our visitors some idea of how this painting had been originally displayed. So our framer and preparator, Andy Haynes, made a design, which you see in the center of your screen, and using old paneling from a room at the MFA that was being demolished, although the paneling was all saved, Andy managed to make something that looked enough like the original design. I'm showing you here our recreation in the American Renaissance Gallery on the right, and on the left, the original setting for this picture in Whitelaw Reid's house. And I think you'll agree that we've managed to recapture some of that stately grandeur that was very, very much a part of Abbey's original conception for this picture. Well, if you walk into the American Renaissance Gallery on the second floor south pavilion, I just want to point out that another Abbey came on the market while we were dealing with the first one. This one is a medieval rather than a Renaissance story picture. It's called The Bridge, and we just snapped it up. It was painted in England, displayed in London. It entered a British private collection, a man who was a big supporter of Abbey's and of the Pre-Raphaelites. And that private collector gave this picture to the National Gallery of South Africa, who deaccessioned it in the 1940s. And it ended up in a private collection of a South African family whose grandson came to Hollywood, turned out to be the producer of the Texas Chainsaw Massacre, and decided that it was time to sell this picture out of the family. So I think if I drew a map of everywhere this picture had been, you'll get a good sense of the sort of far reach of American art. I want to end our journey about paintings, our journey around the world, with a Boston picture, another new acquisition, this one, My Sister Lydia, from 1888. We've already met the artist, Edmund Tarbell, who you see here at the left in a photograph, and I've already showed you his mother and child with a boat on the right. Tarbell was born in Boston. He studied at the School of the Museum of Fine Arts, and as I said, he became one of the innovators of the American Impressionist style. He later became one of the leading painters in Boston and the seminal figure of the so-called Boston School, to which we've devoted a gallery in the wing, which I'll get to in just a second. This picture of Lydia, which you now see on the right, is a depiction of Tarbell's sister-in-law, Lydia Souther. And it was made in 1888, about 5 minutes after John Singer Sargent's first solo exhibition closed at the St. Botolph Club. And I'm showing you here on the left three paintings that were in Sargent's exhibition. The great portrait of Mrs. Gardner from the Gardner Museum, our own portrait of Mrs. Edward Darley Boyd, and our own portrait of Mrs. Inches. The two center paintings are featured in the Sargent Gallery upstairs. Well, what did the American artists who were living in Boston make of this guy Sargent, who was coming in and taking all of their customers and showing them in this very stylish, sophisticated, cosmopolitan way? Well, he was the competition. And artists like Tarbell were determined to show that they, too, could make stylish, beautiful, cosmopolitan-looking pictures of women. And Tarbell made this portrait of his sister, Lydia, almost as an advertisement for his own skill, for his ability to make wonderful portraits. It's very lively, very fluidly painted, and very much in the style of Sargent. Its acquisition allowed us to do something else as well. It allowed us to present a full range of Tarbell's accomplishment as a figure painter. We already owned a very early one, which you see now on the left, a portrait of a young Boston girl named Marion Fenno, dressed up for an evening masquerade entertainment. You can see how tight and academically accomplished Tarbell was with that very finished look, very polished surface. And then we, with our new acquisition, could show him branching out in figurative work towards a looser style, very much, as I said, based on Sargent's work. And then, still later, the painting that you see on the right, also by Tarbell, painted in 1914, called Reverie, showing his combination, if you will, of the academic accomplishments of his early career with his interest in light of the second phase of his career. And it's pictures like the one on the right that earned Tarbell acclamation as the head of the Boston School. Well, first we thought we were going to hang Lydia in the gallery with other 19th century portraits, like this one by William Merritt Chase, which also shows a very sort of stylish turn of the century image of a woman, this particular one shown at the 1893 World's Fair. But in the end, we decided that the Tarbell looked best as a focal point in the gallery that is devoted to the Boston School, where in a way it shows a new kind of woman in the Boston School gallery, women who might be defined perhaps as new women, women who weren't afraid to be painters like Ellen Day Hale and Gretchen Rogers, who you see on the left and right, or women who weren't afraid to present themselves in a forthright manner. And that hand-on-hip pose was very much associated with a modern woman who was perfectly capable of doing everything that she pleased. I hope you can see how these new acquisitions have reshaped the kinds of stories that we can tell about American art in the wing. And in fact, one of the most American features of this work is the fact that it does bring in strands from so many different cultures around the world. As Henry James said, that Americans had the ability to pick and choose, and in his words, to claim our artistic property wherever we find it. Thank you.
Any questions?
Eric, I have a question about who's collecting in Boston, because there seems to be two distinct schools. There's the Boston Impressionists, and then there's the Boston people like Sargent, like Johnston, who are a little bit more traditional. They don't cross over. While they're very colorful and exuberant, they don't cross over into that Impressionism. I know Mrs. Gardner's collecting everybody, but is there a group in Boston that strictly goes for Impressionists, and is the other group that goes for the Sargents and the Brecks and the Albies, or do they overlap?
It's very interesting because most of the collectors that I've studied in Boston didn't draw the line at nationality at all. And the same collectors who you see buying Monet and Renoir in the 1890s in Boston are the collectors who are buying Tarbell and Sargent and everybody else. So this distinction between collecting French art and collecting American art actually didn't hold at all in the late 19th century with these Boston collectors. That's one of the things I find so interesting about it. You have to think, really, that they are collecting contemporary art. We look at people who collect contemporary art now, and they have a very global outlook, and they collect art from lots of different places. Well, the 19th century Bostonians were being pretty avant-garde in their collecting as well. A lot of the pictures that they bought were only 10 years old at the time that they painted them. And I always ask people to think, well, what would you buy that's 10 years old now? That's the mindset that we might put ourselves in. There is another group of collectors who were more interested in old master paintings. Mrs. Gardner bridged both. She bought both, but she never bought a Monet. Everybody else in Boston was doing that. You know, she couldn't probably bring herself to do what everybody else was doing. But there is also another circle who is collecting art of the American past, works by Copley and others who come to new prominence in the late 19th century. Copley Square is named Copley Square in 1883. Anybody else? Yeah.
Would you say there are collectors of that caliber today who might somehow be changing what we want to look at or what we do look at or the future of art in the city?
Absolutely. I do think there are collectors of that caliber today. We're hoping that we have all of them in our Rolodex. But I think if you just go upstairs into the Lindy family wing and look at what we've acquired in the last few years, and also at some of the things that are generously being lent to us right now from a variety of collectors, both local and otherwise, you'll see that, yes, there absolutely are people who are going to transform our vision. And in 100 years, it'll be interesting to come back and see. We have the benefit of hindsight now when we're looking at collectors in the 1890s. I'm sure there were plenty of people who were buying things that we right now no longer think are important. In 40 years, we might think they're very important and find new collectors in the 19th century as well as new collectors in our own time.
Were many of these painters using Fenway Studios at the time?
Good question. The question is about Fenway Studios. If you don't know where that is, it's a wonderful studio building on Ipswich Street, about a 10-minute walk from the MFA. The Fenway Studio building was built in, it opened in 1905 as a purpose-built artist's studio building, and it still is an artist's studio building. And Tarbell and Benson and others did have space there. Not the artists in the 1890s, obviously, because it hadn't been built yet. But yes, Fenway Studios becomes a big center for the so-called Boston School, which really happens after the turn of the 20th century.
Hi, Erica. I wondered, what happened in Boston? What stopped the collecting? What put us on the the slow track during the 20s, 30s, and 40s.
That's another lecture, I think, Judy. Boston, the museum did become quite conservative as a collecting institution, and I think there are a lot of reasons for that. It really is very complicated, and but I think that the story we know isn't the full story. Because there were a lot of people interested in modern and contemporary art in Boston in the 20th century. A lot of them were affiliated with Harvard with the institution that preceded the Institute of Contemporary Art. There were artists who were working in a more modern vocabulary here in Boston, and we just haven't done the work to learn as much as we can about that. The museum itself was conservative, but there are other collectors and other galleries and other artists who were very much more forward-looking in Boston in the 30s and 40s than the artists who were still painting in a Boston school vocabulary. I think it's really, really interesting and something that we need to learn a lot more about. The other thing that happens is that New York really becomes gallery central. And so you can struggle in Boston or you can move to New York, and that happens quite a bit as well. But I think if you look at the collections of some of the other local institutions, and I'm thinking particularly of an artist of a place like the Rose at Brandeis, they have an incredible collection of 20th century art, a collection that did not come here, but it existed. Great, I want to turn things over to Kelly, because I, for one, am really looking forward to hearing about innovation in the 19th century. Thank you.
Good morning. Thank you, Erica. There we go. Well, that's always a tough act to follow when you have John Singer Sargent and all these wonderful paintings, some of which are familiar, and as Erica pointed out, some are new friends. Along this theme of what's new in the wing, We know that many people come to the MFA expecting to see American Impressionism. They expect to see sort of the greatest hits of American art, Copley, Sargent, Cassatt. Maybe they come to see our period rooms like the Oak Hill rooms. But what's really new in the installation of the Art of the Americas Wing is the integration of decorative arts and other media throughout the wing. And I think by now you've probably all had a chance to see that, but I still have visitors remark on that to me when I give gallery talks or when I'm in the galleries of, I love how you've mixed everything together and these must be all new objects. Well, they're not. They are our familiar collection of decorative arts as well as many new acquisitions, but some of these old friends are displayed in new ways. And we hope with a richer context for understanding. So what I'm going to focus on today are decorative arts of the 19th century, probably some little-known or lesser-known objects that are some of my favorites because I think they tell wonderful stories about the mindset of the 19th century, the thirst for novelty, for innovation, for new technologies, this very expansive worldview that was so prevalent in the 19th century. So we'll start with this really sort of wacky object, the Roswell Gleason and Sons Magic Caster. This is the object that you're seeing on the left side of the screen, and it's patent drawing. It's catalog illustration on the right from the Gleason and Sons sales catalog of 1866. So this object captures it all. It is a novel design. What is it? It looks like some sort of spaceship. What it actually is a condiment set. A caster set was for holding little glass bottles of things like ketchup, mustard, salt, pepper, and vinegar. But what the Gleason novelty caster sets did was they had these doors that rotate open. I think you can see in the illustration here, these are shown with the doors spun around open to reveal the contents. And the way that you do that is by turning this little knob at the base and all six doors spin open simultaneously. So it's sort of this party trick that you can do at your dinner table. There's no functional reason why you need that. It is just for the fun and the novelty of it. The piece is also an example of new technology. It's silver plate. It's a very large object. If this were made of sterling silver, the cost would be prohibitive, and you certainly wouldn't make this sort of fanciful novelty trick object out of a material as costly as sterling silver. So it's silver plate using new industrial technologies that made it possible to produce articles of silver plate on a pretty large scale and make them affordable for the growing middle class of the period. It is also a patented object, and while the patent office opened in the early 19th century to help protect American inventors, patents became a craze of their own, and it became a marketing tool in the 1860s, 70s, 80s, where manufacturers wanted to very proudly announce that whatever new gizmo they had was patent, because that meant that it was new, and it was up to date, and it was very modern. And so the caster set, if you look at it in the gallery, the patent stamp is very prominently placed at the top of the object. You would think that this sort of commercial technological bit would be sort of stamped on the underside as an afterthought, but no, it's proudly displayed because the manufacturer knows that this is what the consumer wants to see. And then lastly, Roswell Gleason and Sons, which is a local firm based here in Dorchester, marketed and distributed their goods on a national scale, and so that's why you have this beautifully illustrated catalog, which we have here in the collection thanks to the generosity of Ulf and Betsy Haida, who Betsy is a descendant of the Gleason family and donated a large number of his papers. So this is a page from that 1866 catalog, and we have Mr. Gleason's own copy with his wholesale prices penciled in, so we know what these things sold for. Well, another kind of local innovation and new technology was in the manufacture of pressed glass, which is sometimes popularly known as sandwich glass for the Boston and Sandwich Glass Company in Sandwich, Massachusetts at the sort of, Lower Cape. And this is this local business that grew, again, to national proportions with a huge network of national distribution for these objects that, like silver plate, as an affordable alternative to sterling silver, pressed glass was an affordable and stylish alternative to very costly cut glass and crystal. And what made this possible was this new technology developed by Deming Jarvis and others of pressing glass into a mold. So the glass is in a liquid state, but rather than being poured into a mold, which is a technology that had been around for several thousand years, they developed a way to press the glass into the mold using a plunger, which allowed the glass to really be pushed into these tiny little crevices in the mold to achieve great detail, very fine, delicate patterns. And so it's this new technology of pressing that makes the glass look more like cut glass in the fineness of its detail. It also allows for this great novelty of design that could be very quickly changed just by carving a new mold, so you could keep up with all the changing styles of the 19th century by issuing new sets of patterns. What made this affordable was the labor-saving ability of the glass press, and the illustration at the bottom, I absolutely love. This is actually taken from a page in a coloring book that's published by the Corning Museum of Glass. I thought it was the best line drawing to illustrate this. Whereas cut glass, that was a craft, an ancient craft, and required years of training and a highly developed skill to cut glass effectively. A pressing machine just needed two people with no experience. They could literally be kids brought in from the street and employed in the factory. One person brought the hot glass to the mold. The second cut off the right amount of glass to drop into the patterned mold, which was made of either iron or brass. And then you pull the plunger down to squeeze this hot, soft glass into the mold. And so a decorated piece could come out of the press in a few seconds. So fully formed piece of glass every few seconds, rather than an object that might take a craftsman half a day or more to engrave. Here's a close-up of a beautiful and very rare example of a cake tray from the Boston and Sandwich Glass Company. It's one of the most elaborate designs for lacy pressed glass. And I think this large picture lets you get a sense of the quality of the detail in this kind of glass. But what's interesting is that this detail was produced not just for design's sake, but also to cover up the boo-boos in the glass. The contact of this hot glass being pushed quickly into a cold mold could produce wrinkles in the hot glass and little bubbles and blips. And so designers made these all-over elaborate designs with this characteristic stippled background, these little dots that cover the whole surface. Here's one of those wrinkles that it sort of camouflages nicely. And so this eliminated these marks. And it wasn't until the 1840s, as the pressing technology evolved and they made a few improvements to the machines, that the patterns could become simpler. So the early pieces tend to have this patterning that took on the name of lacy glass. When you go to the gallery, I encourage you to look closely at the objects and see if you can find some of those sort of goofs and wrinkles and so on that are being covered up with this patterning. Well, as I mentioned, patent technology became a craze, and it continued well into the 1870s. And George Hunzinger was a furniture maker who took great advantage of the fascination with patents and his own interest in mechanization and design. Patents, you should know, were granted for particular improvements, something that made something work better than anything previous. They weren't necessarily for a style or a pattern, but they were for something that actually made a difference in function. So a patent technology could then be used in many different styles of objects. And what you're seeing here is a 1869 patent by George Hunzinger for a chair. And the improvement that he's patenting here is the diagonal brace that sort of solves the problem of supporting the chair. You know, if people wanted to tilt back in their chairs, it's really bad for the frame, it weakens the legs, detaches them from the seat, and this diagonal brace supports the chair more fully. He then used that in a whole range of styles of chairs, and we're lucky enough to have this wacky-looking piece on the right that has that same diagonal brace, but you can see that it's applied in a slightly different style. So what is the style of this chair? It doesn't fit into any of our neat categories of neoclassical or Rococo or terms you may have heard of. What it is celebrating modernity. It's celebrating the new, the mechanical, the modern. It's like a patent drawing expressed in form. It both reveals its own machine manufacture in all the turned elements, like these simple turned sort of rod shapes and knobs. It also has these incised grooves on the legs and the braces that are just cut with a router, and there's no pretending that these are handmade. It is very obviously made by machine, of course assembled and finished by human workers, but there's no effort to pretend that this is some hand-carved rarity. So it reveals the machine work, and it also looks like a machine. It looks like it's going to get up and do something. And I'm often asked, oh, is it a folding chair? Is it mechanical? It's not. It doesn't fold, but it looks like it's made of moving parts with cogs and gears and pistons. So Hunsinger is very deliberately celebrating the advent of new technology rather than trying to disguise it with historical flourishes. That said, innovation is not limited to machine work and industrial design, and Erica showed this beautiful John Lafarge window in her talk earlier in relation to painting, and at the time stained glass in the late 19th century underwent a huge revival where it was seen as a comparable kind of fine art. And it was moving in new directions. John Lafarge and Louis Comfort Tiffany both started using stained glass for commissions for private secular uses, not just church and spiritual settings. So it was now made with secular themes that related to other branches of the arts. And in this case, in our beautiful window, Peonies Blown in the Wind, it's referring to the interest in Japanese art that, again, Erica alluded to in paintings of the period. This, I should mention, was made in 1886, but collected in 1913, so it's very much part of that early, ambitious period of MFA collecting that we spoke about earlier, when the museum was collecting what was, in effect, contemporary decorative art. This window by Lafarge is especially good for illustrating the new techniques being used in this. Not only was it new in the sense of being secular, but it was new in that it was not following the technique for medieval stained glass, which is flat pieces of different colored glass, which are then have the details painted on with black lines used for shading. In this case, Lafarge wanted to use glass itself. He wanted to use the medium itself to create three-dimensional effects. And so this is done in several different ways. He used opalescent glass, which is the sort of milky, swirled, semi-translucent glass, to give different layers of depth. He sometimes plated several thicknesses of glass together to create a darker area, to create a new color, sort of building up these thick layers of glass. And then lastly, in this detail, you can very clearly see the carving of these individual flowers where he's cutting into the glass. So this is a piece of red glass, but it looks darker in the areas that are thicker and lighter in the areas that have been carved away and allow more light to pass through. He also used three-dimensional jewel-like chunks of glass in the border, and this you've really got to go look at in the gallery. They're sort of like very like golf ball-sized marbles of glass that just glow from within because of this three-dimensional effect. Well, for this part of the lecture, I'll walk you through the sort of the parade of styles that you think of in the 19th century. I mentioned before how the Hunsinger chair really didn't fit into any particular category of style. So there are plenty of things that don't fit an orderly timeline of first it's this style and then it's the next style. In the 19th century, many styles overlapped and were fashionable at the same time. The spirit of the age was eclecticism. And eclecticism has come to mean now sort of a grab bag. You see this term all the time in, you know, the Pottery Barn catalog or any number of home furnishing magazines. That sort of means it's a hodgepodge. What it was intended to mean, and the way the word was used in the 19th century, was that it was about careful selection of the best elements of the past to be used for modern purposes. So it was intended to be a very thoughtful distilling and selecting of past styles and past ideas. And it was also often used very creatively. So I think when some people look at revival styles and say, oh, well, it doesn't look anything like medieval furniture. It's such a poor copy. The intention was not copying. The intention was to select and adapt to the modern present. The two chairs I'm showing you here represent the Gothic revival, a style that was fairly briefly in fashion in the 1840s and 50s and then passed out of favor. But it's a wonderful style because it really shows you this kind of eclectic making of choices. What the designers borrowed from the Gothic, from the medieval styles, were these architectural motifs from the spires of cathedrals and castles. And so all these, the vertical thrust of these objects is very apparent, much like the vertical thrust of great European cathedrals at Chartres and various other places. The tracery, these carved, pierced, openwork areas are meant to recall the stonework, the carved stonework in buildings. And then there are things that just don't really make any sense, like these little carved points dangling down here below the front rail of the seat. But they have parallels in the pointed arched windows of churches and so on. And then very often they're combined with completely modern things, like these turned legs, which are sort of standard everyday turned legs for furniture with these other Gothic architectural elements applied. The chair on the left is especially wonderful because it retains its original needlework upholstery seat, which resembles a stained glass window. So you can see the importance of original upholstery when it survives in conveying the whole effect that the piece of furniture was intended to give when it was first made. The chair on the right, which is much less comfortable looking and was in fact much less comfortable, is a hall chair. And the Gothic style was often used for hall furniture because it has this sort of sturdy, severe architectural effect. And so this chair was really just a place for a visitor or a messenger to perch, maybe to take off wet boots or rest an umbrella during their brief interlude in the hall before they would go into the parlor and sit in something much more comfortable or slightly more comfortable, like the chair on the left. So why the Gothic? Why were 19th century people looking for reviving things from the medieval past? It was part of the spirit of Romanticism, this idea of embracing emotional associations with the past, with picturesque scenery rather than very orderly neoclassical styles. It's something that, it's a spirit that admires the roughness of a tumble-down cottage or a crumbling old castle ruin. And this is throughout the literature of the period. One of the best descriptions of it comes from Andrew Jackson Downing, an American author who wrote The Architecture of Country Houses in 1850, which became an important style and decorating bible of sorts for the mid-19th century. And he talks about the importance of situating, of the relationship between the landscape and architecture and the picturesque. He says, "It is in such picturesque scenery as this, wherever indeed the wildness or grandeur of nature triumphs strongly over cultivated landscape, that the highly picturesque country house or villa is instinctively felt to harmonize with and belong to the landscape. It is here that the high tower, the steep roof, and the boldly varied outline seem wholly in keeping with the pervading spirit of mysterious power and beauty in romantic scenery." So if you can see these chairs as sort of miniature villas with the high tower and the steep roof and the boldly varied outline, I think you can see how that idea of the picturesque and the Gothic translated into these rather modest chairs for use inside the home. The Gothic Revival also has some moments that I find almost humorous. They're so whimsical. On the left is a fabulous Gothic Revival teapot, a very recent acquisition that we got in 2010, just as we were getting ready to open the wing. And what's fun about this is these little crenellations around the rim, which you also see here on a watercolor of an American Gothic villa. A watercolor by an unknown artist, but very much the kind of house that Andrew Jackson Downing was promoting. And crenellations come from medieval fortifications, right? It's something for archers to hide behind while they're shooting arrows at the enemy that's trying to cross the moat. So somehow the notion that you have to have this defensive architecture on your teapot or on your suburban home, I find a really kind of funny use of the style, but it's an example of this eclectic choice of things, not for a literal practical purpose or for a direct copying from the past, but rather for this association with the romance of the medieval world. Well, moving on to the Rococo Revival, this style is probably a bit more familiar to you, and in fact, this may be what you see in your mind's eye when you think of the Victorian, this very lacy floral style. And what we have here on the left is a side chair made of pressed laminated woods which is a new technology often associated with John Henry Belter, a New York cabinet maker who's well known for making furniture with this technique, but we have discovered that it was widely used by many manufacturers. What that lamination process does is it's taking several thin sheets of wood that are cut on a sawmill, glued and pressed together under great pressure to make them really stick together. And what makes it especially strong is that the wood is glued at cross grain. So you have grain running this way and grain running that way, and it's built up like a sandwich. And that way the wood can't move, can't expand and contract and crack as easily as a single piece of wood might. And with that strength, it allows you to build the back of a chair that is pierced with this incredible fineness. That would just snap if you tried to carve that out of regular wood. But with lamination, you could achieve that. So the new technology fed into this elaboration of the Rococo style. This revival style could do more than the 18th century Rococo furniture because they could be a little wilder and freer with the kind of carving that they used on the backs of these chairs. On the right, there's no new technology involved at all. This is a silver teapot by William Gale and Sons from the 1850s. And this is Rococo revival style, but using the traditional method of hand-raising silver, using hammers at a bench. So this is not the plated wares like the Roswell Gleason novelty objects that we saw. This is hours and hours of very elaborate repoussé, which is hammering out from the inside of the vessel to make these raised bunches of grapes and their leaves, and then chasing, which is hammering with a little punch from the outside of the vessel to sort of highlight these details. These dark outlines are created by chasing. Very labor intensive, and I'm showing you this to make the point that not everything in the 19th century was spat out of a machine. It wasn't all mass produced, and that's often a stereotype of mid-19th century objects. Both mechanical innovation and handwork were happening at the same time. Later in the 19th century, during the aesthetic movement, we get the craze for art from Japan and from other parts of what was then called the Far East, from Asia. Fans became almost a symbol of the idea of art for art's sake, of beauty for its own sake, and fans were widely used simply to decorate walls in interiors. And then they also inspired works like the Lewis Comfort Tiffany Favrille glass fan vase on the left. As Erica showed you in that wonderful slide with Le Domino Rose in the vignette setting we created in the American Wing, these objects were meant to be massed together to create this harmony within an interior of exotic objects from abroad as well as things that were locally made to harmonize with them. Well, not only were painters influenced by Japanese woodblock prints, but so were cabinet makers. And this masterpiece by Herder Brothers is a sideboard, but it is really meant for display. It's not so much about storing your dinner dishes and your silver, although you could use it for that. It's about displaying the piece of furniture itself and carefully placed Asian ceramics on each of the niches, which as it's installed in the gallery, you can see it with ceramics on the shelves and in the niches. What's interesting about this is it blends Western form with Japanese motifs and decoration. The sideboard is almost neoclassical in feel. It's completely symmetrical. It has these slender vertical legs. It's not unlike sideboards of the federal period, the early neoclassical style. But the motifs in marquetry and in the gilt and stamped paper, which is original and remains intact, are derived from Japanese woodblock prints, painted screens, and printed papers. And so all of those motifs are sort of mixed together in this wonderful stew of Japanesque ornament. What's especially wonderful to look at closely in the gallery, and you'll notice I keep alluding to the galleries because I want you to come from this lecture and go spend some time really looking closely at these objects, is the level of detailed natural ornament. This is something that's taken directly from Japanese painting and prints, where there's an incredible level of detail with these dragonflies and butterflies and other insects down here with the leaves. If you go look closely, you'll see where a beetle has been munching little holes in the leaves, and this is all rendered in inlaid different colors of wood. It's quite wonderful. Well, in the same gallery where we have the Abbey painting with its grand fireplace surrounds, we also have some smaller scale objects that also express the idea of the American Renaissance. And this is a period of vastly expanding American global power and cultural development. And so many Americans really wanted to show off and quite openly said, we are the inheritors of Western civilization. I mean, it was a very pompous era in many ways. And some of the works of art created in this period are meant to express that kind of success in developing an American art and American culture. The claret jug on the left is made by Gorham, and many of you may be familiar with Gorham silver. They made things ranging from elaborate exhibition objects to ordinary sets of silverware. The claret jug was made for exposition. It was never used to hold any claret or any other liquid, as far as we can tell. But it was made for show, and they kept detailed records in the Gorham Company archives. The subject took 150 hours of labor to make and an additional 78 hours of chasing, chasing being that process of the hammer and the little punch delicately outlining the details on the design. It cost $240 to make, so that's not the retail price. It has 61 inset gems, so it is just a statement of lavishness in this beautiful, rather compact, it's about this high, crystal, gilt, metal-wrapped, and gem-encrusted vessel. On the right is a gold double eagle coin. This is among the smallest works of art on view in the wing, and it was designed by Augustus St. Gaudens, who was, of course, the leading American sculptor of the American Renaissance period, and is known for his grand, large public monuments, such as the Shaw Memorial on Boston Common, the Sherman Monument in New York, and the Adams Memorial in Washington, D.C., all of which are these, you know, large-scale, monumental public figures. This is a work of public art that fits in your pocket. It's a gold coin worth $20. That's why it was known as a double eagle, an eagle being a $10 coin, double eagle, $20. And it was, this line of coinage was commissioned by President Theodore Roosevelt, who said, quote, he wanted to have American coins that were worthy of ancient Greece. So he wanted coinage to stop being this sort of humdrum thing designed by some engraver at the mint that could be produced quickly and become something that was a public expression of the power and the grandeur of the United States. So I think we get this very elegant, striding woman. She sort of recalls Nike of Samothrace with her bold forward movement and her flowing gown. But you have to remember that this is done in miniature and in very, in relief to fit on the surface of a coin. And yet it manages to have this kind of power of a public monument. When you go to the gallery, look for the coins case and compare this example from 1907, which is the higher relief version, that is what St. Gaudens originally intended, with the lower relief version of the same design that the mint master eventually prevailed with because it was easier to make and because the high relief coins didn't stack as neatly in stacks. So there is a little bit of push-pull between artists wanting to design things for their artistic merit and then the sort of practical-minded and you might say small-minded side of mint production. So we have both in the case, and it's a very nice looking exercise to try to compare the two and see which you think is more successful. The next era of style, if you want to call it that, although it was happening really simultaneously with these very extravagant American Renaissance furnishings, is the idea of design reform. So what we have here is a chair on the left that was manufactured by a large firm in New York, Killian Brothers. It was made about 1870, and it's part of that more is more aesthetic. It's a bit like the Hunzinger chair with all the knobs and doohickeys. The upholstery is our recreation, but it's very much in keeping with the kind of mixed patterning and trims and bands of decoration that you would see in upholstery of chairs like this. And so it's really, it's got a little bit of everything. It's vaguely like Louis XVI furniture with its turned, reeded legs and the round back, but it's also got gewgaws that are just purely of the 1870s. So there were a number of writers and designers and artists in the late 19th century who wanted to clear the decks, get away from all of that, from all these fripperies of machine-produced ornament that they found tacky and dishonest. I mean, I think they're creative and wonderful, but you can look at it in various ways. Some reformers advocated handcraft more than others, and that's where we get the arts and crafts movement, which I'll come back to. Others said that it was really more about the design, that it was okay to use the machine, but that the machine should be used appropriately and honestly. There's always this moral language to reform. And so the chair on the right was designed by Frank Lloyd Wright in 1900. And so very much contemporary with these American Renaissance things and other really elaborate furniture we've looked at. But Wright advocated the use of the machine for design, and he, as an architect, was used to, I design something and somebody else makes it. So this chair is not an expression of his personal handcraft. It's machine-cut boards and posts assembled into this very elegant, very simple, repetitive design with a beautiful rhythm of these strips across the backsplat. On the handcraft side of things, we have the Saturday Evening Girls and the Paul Revere Pottery here in Boston. This is a group of objects that were another wonderful new acquisition for the wing, a gift of, I can't remember how many pieces of pottery, but many, many examples of Saturday Evening or Paul Revere Pottery decorated by Sarah Gellner, a woman who grew up in Boston, and they were given in her memory by her son, David L. Bloom. So it was a great opportunity to study the Paul Revere pottery in greater depth. And not only was this part of the handcraft side of design reform, the idea that things made by hand are inherently better somehow than things made by machine, it's also part of the social reform aspect that went along with design reform. It's part of the idea that craft and making things by hand is a way to uplift and inspire and reform people's lives. So the Paul Revere Pottery was founded in 1908, and it was based on a club. It came out of a club for immigrant girls, mostly Jewish, Eastern European immigrants, and Italian immigrants in the North End in that period. The club was founded by Edith Guerrier and Edith Brown, who were both librarians at the Boston Public Library, so they were exposed to a beautiful artistic environment there with the Abbey murals and the contributions of many other artists there, and believed in this idea of art as being part of a wholesome environment. The project was funded by Helen Osborne Storrow. You may recognize the name from Storrow Drive. And the pottery went on for several decades and provided a way for these immigrant girls to work together, to work in a healthy, wholesome workshop environment, and produce pottery that could be sold and that could help them make a living. It was a very idealistic kind of use of handcraft in the service of reform. It was always, like many of these kinds of endeavors, it was always sustained in some way by the contributions of its sponsor, Mrs. Storrow. So there's always a bit of tension between the wonderful idea of doing handcraft and actually making it financially viable, which is certainly the case with this next object, which is this incredible silver casket by Boston metalsmith Edward Everett Oakes. Oakes wrote that he, quote, dreamed of leaving a single magnificent work to compare favorably with the great jewelers of the Renaissance. And this casket was that work. This was his magnum opus. It's made of silver, green gold, which is an alloy of gold with a slightly greenish color, 143 amethysts, 18 Japanese pearls, 68 Oriental pearls, 88 pieces of onyx, and a handmade laurel wood base on which it rests. Oakes made this as his masterpiece, and he wanted the MFA. He hoped the MFA would acquire it. But he finished the work in October 1929. That was not a good time for spending a lot of money on lavish works of art with the stock market crash. So the piece remained in his family unsold for 70 years until it was finally purchased by the MFA in 2000. What's wonderful, too, about this piece is it is it's based on the form of a medieval casket. And when you first look at it, it does have this sort of the strap work and the gem set areas do recall sort of Renaissance and medieval decoration. But when you look closely at these details, this is a bit like a stepped skyscraper motif. It's sort of Art Deco in its details as well, which fits in very nicely with its time in the 1920s and 30s. So it's a nice example of how the arts and crafts movement could move forward in the 20th century and begin to absorb some other contemporary design influences as well. I'll conclude with this tea service, which is another recent gift from Lee and Dirk Born, which we acquired just in 2009. So it's another new acquisition for the wing, and it really filled a gap in our collection in representing the Chicago arts and crafts, which is quite different from Boston's arts and crafts. Edward Oakes, with his medieval casket, is very much in keeping with the historical kind of perspective found in Boston arts and crafts artists. In Chicago, there was a greater interest in forward-looking modernism, and if you recall the Frank Lloyd Wright chair, and if you can think of what was known as the prairie style, those very geometric, clean-lined buildings associated with Chicago and the upper Midwest at the turn of the 20th century, this silver tea service is very much in keeping with that. LeBolt and Company, who made this tea service, was actually a very large jewelry firm. So this is the idea of art in industry, which has been going along since the late 19th century. They were a large firm, but in 1912, they decided that because this arts and crafts movement seemed to be sticking around, that they would try to jump on the bandwagon, and they opened a small arts and crafts workshop within their firm. It only lasted for about 5 years, but other places were trying this. Marshall Fields, which was just a few doors down on the same street, also added a craft metal workshop within its business. So there was this little flourishing of how can we incorporate the handmade into something that's more accessible and available to a wider audience. The fact that the LeBolt & Company workshop only lasted 5 years means that having this complete tea service with its tray is incredibly rare. It came down in the Bourne family. It was somebody's wedding gift and just stayed together all these years. Now, while Chicago metalsmiths and Chicago arts and crafts practitioners did tend to emphasize clean lines and modernity, they also wanted you to know that this work was handmade. They wanted modernity and handcraft not to be mutually exclusive. And so the hammer marks are quite pronounced. You can see them even in this slide, and when you go to the gallery and see it well lit, you'll see them even more. 18th century silver doesn't look like this. If you look at Paul Revere, you know, the great silver that we have from the period before industrialization, silversmiths worked incredibly hard to planish out, to smooth out their hammer marks from the initial raising of the piece. They would go back over the surface with a planishing hammer to make it as mirror smooth as possible. That was the sign of good craftsmanship. Here in the 20th century, after the Industrial Revolution has given us every kind of shiny, smooth, perfect surface you can imagine, now the craftsman wants you to know how hard they've worked and that this is not done by machine. So the hammer marks become visible and they really become sort of a decorative aspect of the object with a wonderful sort of faceted, sparkling effect on the surface. So I hope I've given you a lot to think over, some ideas to chew over as you look at 19th century decorative arts in the galleries, and I'm very happy to take questions.
I have a question about the casket. It's not on the handout. What are the dimensions on that?
Oh, I was afraid somebody would ask me that. I don't have the dimensions with me, but it's about this big. Okay. It's about this high. Does that help? Yeah. Sorry. Thank what you. Is that? Eight inches or so? I think the scale of many objects will surprise you. It is. It happens with paintings, but especially with decorative arts. When I show you something blown up on the screen, like that the cake tray, you know, that's about this big. It's not the size of that screen. So that's part of the fun, I hope, for you of exploring these galleries and discovering these things, is being surprised by some things that are larger or smaller than perhaps you expected.
Okay, thank you so much, Kelly. Thank you, Erica,
thank you.
Both of you.